All right, finding global maximums and minimums. The important word there is global. So we're given a function, f of x. Our goal to find these global maximums and minimums is going to rely on, first, we need to take the derivative and figure out when it is either equal to zero or undefined. So taking the derivative usually isn't too bad using the power rule. So 3x squared minus 6x minus 9. All right, now I want to figure out when this equals zero, but a lot of times, if we do some factoring first, it makes our lives easier. So let's go ahead and factor out. We have a 3 in common, so a greatest common factor comes out. X squared minus 2x minus 3 remains. That should factor a little bit further. The x squared should split up as x and x. The 3 can become 1 and 3 because it's prime. That's the only way to factor it. Now we have to be careful about the signs on these, that when you add them together you get a negative 2. But I think if we do positive 1 minus 3, we'll end up with this negative 2 in the middle. All right, this is going to point us towards having critical numbers or critical values at, for this x, that would be at x equals negative 1. And for this x, that's going to be at x equals positive 3. So you may be saying, okay, well, that'll make the derivative equal zero. So we have a possibility of a maximum or minimum there. Those could be local, they could be global, we're not really sure. From here, it actually is pretty easy, the rest of our steps. All you have to do to finish this problem is you want to evaluate back into the original function, negative 1. So negative 1 cubed minus 3 times negative 1 squared minus 9 times negative 1 plus 5. And I think after you work this all the way down, you get 10. So f of negative 1 equals 10. We also want to do the same thing with 3. So f of 3 back into the original. And after a little bit of work, maybe use your calculator to help you out, we should get negative 22. So I know at this point a lot of students stop and they say, okay, 10's big. Negative 22 is small, all right, it's much smaller than 10. So we must have a global maximum at negative 1 and a global minimum, I should say at the y value, maximum at 10, minimum at negative 22. However, where students forget to look is they narrow down which x values we're looking at. All right, we're only looking between negative 2 and positive 6. So sure enough, negative 1 and positive 3 both fit in that range of values for x. However, there's a possibility that we could have an endpoint at negative 2 or at 6 that's actually bigger or smaller than these. So what we want to do is also go back and evaluate our original function at negative 2 and at positive 6. Okay, so negative 2 as we replace each one of the x's, again, in our original function, and work this all the way down, we get f of negative 2 works out to be 3, and f of 6, 6 cubed minus 3 times 6 squared, minus 9 times 6 plus 5, f of 6 works out to be 59. All right, so these are the values we actually want to be comparing. Just to be clear, we have 10, negative 22, 3, and 59. The very, very biggest value is 59. So this is the global maximum. Okay, the very, very, very smallest value we have is that negative 22. Amongst those four. So this is the global minimum. All right, so where people make their mistakes is they get used to doing critical numbers, you know, first derivative, finding those critical numbers or critical values, but they forget about those endpoints for the interval. So also test those endpoints for the interval. They could be the global maximum or minimum. Remember, global, keyword.